Hello everybody. This is another addendum video. We just had an interview with the journalist Anastasia Kuzova from Tsargat TV of Russia, and she posed several questions to me, which I will attempt to answer in this video and post it for our YouTube channel. Okay, her first question was, what conclusions can be made on the geopolitical situation of the world according to my observation of this latest G20 summit that just took place in China? And she was interested in some of the trends that I have observed and some forecasting that we need to make. The second part of that question, by the way, I'm going to pose it now, so we can sort of get it over with in one shot, was the why were a lot of rumors and scandals around this summit. So let's go ahead and start with the first question, some of the conclusions, some of the observations from this summit. As before, we are certainly seeing a trend here. We are seeing a shift of power, of economic power, and some may even suggest political power from West, implying Europe and United States, into East, that being Russia and China. One of the developments that we have been seeing in the past few years, and which was certainly addressed in this summit, was the divisions and what's the word I'm looking for? The riffraffs and the wedge that Washington is driving between China and her neighbors, especially countries like Japan, South Korea, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Philippines, certainly Indonesia and Singapore. Many of these countries feel threatened by Russian, not Russian, by the Chinese, rise of power, especially economic power, and they are being encouraged by Washington, and they're renewing their alliance, their military alliance, with United States. So the U.S. is definitely has a hand in this, in accentuating, in exacerbating, in focusing these differences and these perceived threats to her allies in East Asia and Southeast Asia, certainly. On a side note, we saw this, we all witnessed this argument between President Duterte of Philippines, a very interesting character, very animated, very charismatic, really very colorful, as President Obama put it. His expression of feelings toward the American power and his emphasis that Philippines is not subservient to anybody, implying that Philippines has been subservient and a proxy and an ally of the United States during the past several decades. Some very colorful language, anti-diplomatic language, was exchanged, much to the celebration and much to the dismay of Washington, but much to the celebration of the rest of the world. Here you have a country like Philippines, a developing nation like Philippine, that is really standing up to a loose cannon like President Duterte is standing up to the big, bad, ugly imperialist, and really shaking the foundations of this alliance. But this is not unusual. President Obama, being in his last year or last few months in office, actually, he's very concerned about his legacy and what have you, and a lot about these other G20 leaders were cognizant of that, and they kind of wanted to deprive him of that, much in the same fashion that they deprived George W. Bush of a lot of that in 2008, in that summit, in that G20 summit, where he was publicly humiliated and dissed and snubbed, especially by the Chinese. So we are seeing, the recurrence of that. This seems to be the trend. They want to make sure a U.S. president doesn't feel really, why should I use the word U.S. president? It's more like a CEO of the political mafia power structure, in Washington, not an American president. So the tendency seemed to be wanting to humiliate this CEO of the political power structure in Washington, in any which way possible. So that was an interesting thing that we all saw. A lot of this was media generated, by the way, here in the West. I think as the U.S. empire is being brought into its knees, it's demanding more respect. It's like a cornered animal, in a sense. And here in the internal mood, in the internal political climate in the United States, I think Donald Trump even made a point. Apparently the stairs that get attached to the plane was somewhat delayed by the Chinese, and President Obama was had to stay in Air Force One until the Chinese finally provided these automated stairs. And then Donald Trump was totally, of course, took advantage of that situation and said something that to the fact that if that happened to him, he would have basically took off right away. And these are all signs of a decaying, dying empire that's being snubbed by pretty much everybody else, because everybody else is sick and tired of the hegemonic policies of Washington. To the point that even puppets are becoming sick and tired of being puppets. That would, for example, include the entire GCC heads of state, the Gulf Cooperation Council. Yesterday we saw how the King of Bahrain flew to Russia, and I did an analysis of that with Hasargrad TV as well. I think the interview is a couple of videos beneath this one, where even the puppets, even these Gulf Arab country puppets, are looking for new alliances because they're sick and tired of Washington reneging on his promises. So we are seeing all sorts of geopolitical shifts and maneuvering and gestures in the world. Anastasia Zhukova's second question in regards to the G20 summit is that why don't the negotiations in Syria aren't making any progress? In answering that question, we have to assume that the intent was for these negotiations to make progress, which I'm afraid to say was never the intent. It was certainly negotiations for the sake of negotiations, and the West and NATO, Washington and NATO, to be exact, for them to actually buy time. Mao Zedong said something very interesting. The communist leader of China, he said all wars end with negotiated political settlement. And as the socioeconomic and geostrategic forecaster, I hate to say this, but it seems that NATO is really looking for a battlefield settlement to this issue in Syria, this horrible tragedy in Syria. Washington has been engaged in this concept that we call perpetual war, certainly since the terrible events of September 11, 2001. So in the past 15 years, we've seen this concerted effort in continuation of war, which is in benefit to the military industrial complex here in the US and around the world for that matter. So there was never any good faith. There was never an honest partner in these negotiations over truce or peace in Syria. And then you have this third degree, the Israeli factor. Not too long ago, about a month or so ago, we had the Israeli military intelligence chief publicly state that they would prefer ISIS to be in charge in Syria rather than the secular regime, secular government of President Bashar al-Assad. This was unprecedented, unprecedented. We all knew that the Israelis were supporting and even had a hand in creating these Daesh, ISIS savages in Syria and Iraq. But the Israelis came out in the open, so they are certainly going to exert some influence in making sure the negotiations fail, just like they did with the P5 plus one nuclear negotiations with Iran. and thank God they failed in that one as well. So, and I hate to forecast this, but I believe that NATO and the West are looking to not just the regional war, which is what we have right now. We have a proxy war in the Middle East. You know, we have Iran and Iraq and Lebanon and Syria on one side, along with Russia and possibly Turkey join in, and Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and all these GCC Arab sheikdoms on the other hand. I think NATO is really looking not to settle this. They're not just looking for a regional war, but a global war in which their debts would somehow be wiped off the books. Anytime you had out of control debt, here in the United States, we have a $19 trillion debt. Nobody knows who this debt is owed to. But whenever you have a situation like this, or in the past, in previous times in the 21st century alone, we had a global war. So the hegemonic psychopaths that are running Washington and London are going to try to use this opportunity to widen this conflict beyond the borders of Middle East and certainly North Africa and make it into a global conflict. It is absolute insanity, but that's what they have in mind. So that's an academic, lengthy answer to why the negotiations in Syria are not making any progress. At any rate, we are in a very very crucial point in the fact that the shift of power, political, social, and economic power is being moved to Asia. And on the same token, we have elections here, presidential elections, or as I like to call it, presidential selections, coming up here in the next couple of months. So my forecast is that Secretary Clinton is going to back this election. She was selected to play this role in the 90s since her husband was president. And God help us all, when this woman gets into the presidential office, because from everything that she has, exhibited, she's extremely hawkish, warmonger, the hegemonic, intrusive, under the disguise of democracy and human rights. So, the G20 leaders made sure that this president leaving the office gets a really nice snub before the next one is put in or installed in. At any rate, we'll have to follow these global developments and see what happens with this situation, certainly in Asia, as well as the Syrian situation. This was a topic that was highly discussed at the G20 summit, so we'll have to see what happens, certainly with the coronation of the next American president. Thank you for your interest, and we look forward to our next video.